anybody that's listening that is not familiar with Houdini 100, essentially it was a project that came out of a really, really interesting scenario. Essentially what I did, the end of the story is that I replicated a Harry Houdini stunt in downtown Pittsburgh. But how I got there was, I think it was a cool journey. When I was growing up as a magician, I've been so lucky. I had a magician mentor who I eventually, you know, his name is Paul Gertner. He's not only a fantastic magician, but he's also an incredible businessman in the art of magic.
How early did you meet him?
So I have a really strange connection. Everything with me is always, there's a weird story behind everything I do. My connection with him was when I was a young magician, I was like 12, 13 years old. My godmother had told me that she knew a magician that was really good and that he was doing a show in Pittsburgh. And she wanted to take me to see him. And I was, absolutely, I want to go see a magic show. I was just getting into magic. I was a little cocky magician. I thought I knew everything.
Of course.
But I didn't know who Paul Gertner was yet. And then when I went and saw Paul Gertner and I saw his level of magic and where he was, and it just blew me away. You know, I didn't realize that level of magic existed, that level of talent. And so after the show, she went up and introduced me to him. But when she introduced me to him, she said, "Hey, Lee, this is Paul Gertner, one of my old boyfriends." So my godmother dated him in high school. And of course, when Paul was meeting me in that moment, he's shaking my hand going, "I don't know who this kid is, but why is my ex-girlfriend from 30 years ago standing here, right?" You know what I mean?
It's like he's like trying to do the math. Like, is this my kid?
That introduction and seeing his show lit the match for me to continue on this journey. And it was, I then, you know, looked into Paul and got to know who Paul was and pursued him and looked at him as a mentor, because I was fascinated with not only his ability as a magician and his talent, but I was fascinated by the entrepreneurial aspect of what he was able to do with his talent. And that's why I latched on to him very quickly. And he was very, very receptive to me and open to sharing secrets with me and information. And over time, I became kind of like Paul's right-hand man whenever he would do shows. Like, I knew his show inside and out, so I would run all the tech, right? I was the one pushing all the buttons, controlling the lights, setting up all the tricks and stuff. And so there came a time in 2010 when I was invited on the road with him. And he took me to New York. And it was whenever we were in New York City, I was helping him run his show. The day after his show, we were getting ready to leave. He said to me, "Lee, do you want to go see if we can find Harry Houdini?" And it was like at that moment where I was kind of like, "Hey, Paul, we're going to go see Harry Houdini? Where are we going to, where's he at?" Like, I thought he was buried in like Appleton, Wisconsin. Because when Harry came to America, he ended up settling in Appleton, Wisconsin. So I just naturally assumed that that's where he would probably be buried. But Paul knew he wasn't. He knew he was buried in Queens. We got in a car and went to Queens, and we went to this old cemetery, and we went and we found Harry Houdini's grave. And it was at that moment when we got to hang out at Harry Houdini's grave. It's me, you know, a magician I look up to, and then the greatest magician of all time. We're sitting at this grave talking magic tricks. And then it was like a little serendipity, because when we came back to Pittsburgh, Paul gave me a book. Actually, I have the book. I have the book right here. You're going to see this is a gigantic book, right? Huge book. I have it under glass at the moment. But what it is, it's an extremely rare magic book, right? And in the book.
Oh, yeah. And people just don't keep books in those giant cases like that, you know.
On the regular? No, yeah. No. Not like this.
You're just a big book fanatic?
No, I am actually a huge book fanatic. I am. I do collect old books and old magic books and stuff like that. But this book was very special because when Paul gave it to me, I didn't know this was going to happen, obviously, but that evening, after visiting Harry Houdini's grave, I came home and opened this book, and I went through this thing. You know, I mean, it's absolutely, it's an insane book. It's an absolutely beautiful book, right?
Yeah.
But as I go through this book, I came to this photo that ultimately would change my life, because that photo is the image from Harry Houdini in downtown Pittsburgh. So this is the actual photo in the book that I discovered. Harry is right here. It's hard, really hard to see.
Yeah, I see him
there. And then the building, it says the Pittsburgh Post, and it's dated in the corner on November 6, 1916. So as I discover that image that evening after visiting Harry Houdini's grave, and I discover that Pittsburgh connection, that was the moment. That was the aha moment where I really thought about, wow, you know, I'm a Pittsburgh guy. I can do the straitjacket and escape. Maybe someday I can do that. And it was at that thought, at that moment, that idea entered my brain, that it was, no, I'm going to do that. And I'm going to do it on the exact same day, 100 years to the moment it happened. And not only that, I just kept taking it further. Not only that, I want to do it at the exact same location that it happened, right in front of that building. So I got to find out where that building is. I got to find out where he did it. I wanted to, what exact time was it? What was, you know, I uncovered every stone I could. I called Rick Seaback and I said, Rick, what do you know about this? We can details, you know, I want information. And for the next
shout out to Rick Seaback.
What's that?
I said shout out to Rick Seaback.
Shout out to Ricky, man. He's the man. He is the man when it comes to this stuff. And he's so nice.
I'd love to talk to him.
He's always there to give me, you know, to pick up the phone, and he's so generous with his time. He's such a good Pittsburgher. So he was such a big help in the process in the very beginning. And once I started to get all my details and I started to cement the idea, then it became from, you know, okay, the concept's there. And not only that, I wanted to replicate the photo. So that was one of my main things I wanted to do, is I wanted to replicate that photo in that book. Could I put myself in the exact same position, have thousands of people there, and get the exact same image 100 years to the moment? That was the goal. Could I do it? And that's what I worked on for the next 5.5 years. I just completely dedicated myself to that idea. I remember I would tell people this. Hey, I would have people take out their cell phones. I'd say, go to 2016. Go to November 6th. Put in downtown, put in Houdini. And I would have people save that in their phone, because that's how confident I was the day we'd be standing there that day. I would project those ideas. You know, I would tell people, and as crazy as it was coming out of my mouth, it held me accountable. The more I felt, the more I committed to it, the more I couldn't back out. Right. As time got closer and closer to it. But as I got through the process of cutting through the red tape, of figuring out if I could do this, you know, reaching out to you know, working with the mayor of Pittsburgh and the city and setting everything in motion, then it became, you know, if I can do this on that date and make all these things happen, well, the goal was to share it with the city of Pittsburgh. There was no cover charge. It was a free event. I just wanted people to come and experience a little bit of history in Pittsburgh and some magic. And then it was, you know, how crazy can we take it? Can I get Rick Seaback to show up? Could I get Franco Harris and Rocky Blyer, who is from Appleton, Wisconsin? So this is the Houdini connection of hometown.
Right. Yeah.
Can I get these guys? Can I get Tom Savini, who's a friend, to put me in the straitjacket? You know, like Harry would back in his time. He would get the big strongmen. So big Steelers, I think, would be kind of cool.
Right.
And so once those ideas started coming out of my mouth, right, then it was, let's see if we can make him happen. And I always joke, because I know Franco very well, and he's a sweet guy. I've done a lot of shows for him over the years, and I love him, because when I having him there, I always joke. I say, a lot of people, when you came to see, you know, see that stunt, it's unfortunate. It's like watching a stunt like that. It's like watching a train wreck, right? You're kind of rooting for something bad and crazy to happen, right?
I promise you, I was not. I was there. Okay, well, I was not rooting for anything bad to happen.
Well, in my mind, having Franco there, I knew I was in good hands, because he would catch me if I fell. Right? he, you know, the immaculate reception of me would happen. But no, it was these layers of the onion that, as I peeled them away, the more energized I became about putting the project, you know, together. And I couldn't wait to announce it because I'd been working on it for 5.5 years, you know? So I announced it 100 days out, and then it, you know, the marketing in me kicked in. And then it was, how do I publicize this thing and get people to join me on that date? And needless to say, it went off without a hitch. Thousands of people rolled out to it. And as they say, you know, it went the way it couldn't have went any better, man.